Venue to Ottawa, a big country capital with a small town groove. This is the kind of place the guidebooks like to describe as recreational, healthful and bracing. And like Australians with Canberra, the Canadians were left scratching their heads as to why their capital ended up here. I guess that's what happens when you leave that choice to a foreign monarch. In this case, England's Queen Victoria chose a little timber-logging bush backwater with a reputation as North America's most dangerous town. And my, how that's changed. These days, there's an almost audible squeak to its cleanliness. It's green, it's clean, it's young, it's smart, and it's bilingual. Scenic's East Coast tour of Canada continues here on the banks of three sparkling rivers, where Ottawa basks in summer's glory, where a thoroughly modern city is stitched together with a unique thread, reveals a little French passion, a rich First Nation heritage, and a dash of flourish and splendour, United Kingdom style. If it wasn't for the Harry Potter-style Parliament building in the background, you'd swear you were having a Buckingham Palace moment. Each morning during Canada's summer, their very own changing of the guard takes place on Parliament Hill's lawn.
Now, this is how a nation's capital should be, isn't it? All pomp and ceremony and a bearskin hat. But I can't help but think that behind the shiny uniform and the snap of the snare drum lurks the more colourful side of Canadian politics.
The nation's parliamentary business has been conducted at this site since 1867. Back when Canada's first Prime Minister, the truly colourful Sir John A. Macdonald, found all manner of method to deal with opposition attacks.
He was a fascinating character, wasn't he?
He had his quirks, for sure.
Main one being?
He indulged a lot, let's put it that way. He liked his drink.
Yeah, he was a boozer.
Yeah.
I read that he would disappear for days, maybe weeks on end on a bender.
He would disappear, definitely. There is one report of him in a debate in Parliament in which he had to relieve himself of his stomach contents in the middle of the debate.
Oh, that's a fine debate when that happens.
Well, he actually blamed it on his opponent. He said that he couldn't stomach his opponent's arguments.
There's a story behind the flag.
Yeah, the flag on the Peace Tower changes every single day. So someone goes up and puts a new flag up every day. Canadians can put their name on a list to receive one of the flags that's flown on Parliament Hill. However, the catch is that the waiting list right now is something like 30 years long.
This being a bilingual city, is all the business of Parliament done in two languages?
Everything is done in French and in English.
And it's not just the business of Parliament which is conducted in French and English. Even if you don't speak either language, an Ottawa river cruise reveals many of this city's fascinating landmarks. It also shows how becoming either Prime Minister or US Ambassador will guarantee a nice pad above the river, like these.
Is that whenever you see the flag of your country that's flying above or near their home, that means that the ambassador is here in Canada.
Long before the Europeans ever dipped a toe in, the Algonquin cruised this river, feathered headdress, bow and arrow, faithful squaw and all. This was their vital trade route. Food, furs, skin, a shared peace pipe or two. They called this river the Kitchissippi, and their word for trade was Ottawa. The Europeans, busy mangling their own language, needed to simplify things, so they changed the name of the river from Kitchissippi to Ottawa and named the city after the river. You with me? Otherwise, the Canadian seat of government would now be in a place called Kitchissippi. And that would be too hard.
As our cruise returns to shore, I realise a nice pad above the river is not the exclusive domain of prime ministers and ambassadors. The Fairmont Château Laurier not only commands a prime position above the water, it puts guests right in the heart of Ottawa.
Believe me, you are blessed when you travel with Scenic. You'll always find yourself in a magnificent hotel such as this. The man responsible for the construction of this hotel was a guy called Charles Melville Hayes. He was returning from business in London for the opening of the hotel back in 1912 when he went down with the Titanic. The opening of the hotel was postponed out of respect for him. There are some who believe that you can still find him wandering the corridors late at night, but they'd be wackos, wouldn't they? There's no such thing as a ghost. A
After a couple of days in Ottawa with Scenic's East Coast Canada tour, we've arrived here in the city affectionately known as La Vieille Capitale. To attempt to explain Quebec City without a bit of history would be like attempting to eat flake without a minimum of chips. It just can't be done. Suffice to say, since being permanently settled back in 1608, this city has been French, then English, then French, then English, then French, then English, while always being part of Canada. You with me? First business district, first hospital, first church built of stone, first girls' school, first Anglican church in North America, all here, conveniently located within the only walled city on the continent north of Mexico. But if history isn't the kind of thing that inspires your drool, I'll tell you, the knockout splendour of this place will. This city's splendour could hardly be more evident than here in the lower town. Not short of places of great beauty around here, are you?
Oh, this is this street especially. It was recently voted the most beautiful street in Canada, and I can't disagree. It is beautiful this time of year in the summertime. It's beautiful especially in the wintertime. Picture fresh snow on the ground, Christmas trees, Christmas lights strung across the way. It's spectacular.
Although the old town of Quebec City lies conveniently within the city walls, there's a steep incline between the two areas known as Lower and Upper Town. A two-buck funicular ride saves any aerobic ordeal.
Historically, was there a difference between the lower town and here on the upper town?
Absolutely. Traditionally, there was a difference between the upper and the lower. The upper classes lived in the upper town, the lower classes in the lower town. The people who loaded the ships lived in the lower town. The people who owned the ships lived in the upper town.
Upper town, lower town, upper class, lower class, Anglican, Catholic. Here in Quebec City, it seems there's always been some kind of distinction.
This is the first Anglican cathedral built outside of the British Isles.
I particularly like the spire.
It is beautiful. In fact, they say that the bishop who oversaw the construction of the church, apparently he wanted one thing from his church. He wanted to make sure that the bell tower in his church was taller than the bell tower in the Catholic church on the next block.
Oh, great.
That's right.
Quebec City would perhaps not have such a rich history if it wasn't for the St. Lawrence River. The name Quebec means the river narrows here, and ultimately it was control of the river that the French and British fought for.
Can you imagine the sin and the strife and the bawdy kind of life going on down here back in the mid-1800s? That was when those Celtic cads and bounders, the Irish and Scots, having fled famine and destitution back in the homeland, would hang out, drinking, thieving, womanising, brawling, and generally helping to distribute the odd bit of wayward cargo, and all done beneath the bountiful bellies of the toffs up there in Upper Town.
From Upper Town's prized position overlooking the St. Lawrence River and appearing every bit as if it were the castle of a mythical god is Le Château Frontenac. And although I'm usually sceptical of such pronouncements, when you look as grand as this, you could hardly deny Château Frontenac's claim as the most photographed hotel in the world. Inside, there's the kind of opulence that almost inspires you to grab a cloth and polish some brass, except it's clearly already been done. Guests are assured a Chateau Frontenac room at this scenic special stay, but one such as this may require you to wrestle the likes of rumoured previous guests Paul McCartney or Leonardo DiCaprio out of the bed.